The upper room, yeah!
Living just enough.
Welcome to the upper room. I'm your host, King Cleve, along with my co-host, Zeke, the 5 foot freak, and the legend that is Larry. We got a very special show for you today. We have some special guests in here. Man, something close to the heart. Something that everyone should see, and if you have children, I really think that this is something that you should let them tune in on. But before we get to that, we'll jump over to the legend and let him let you know what gives him
the red ass.
Don't judge me, huh? You know, that's the phrase that the preachers like to use. Don't judge me, I'm only human.
Right.
Shouldn't we have a certain level of expectation? I mean, they put themselves in that situation. There's a level of behavior that we should expect. It's supposed to be guidance, right?
Right.
Reverend Wilson, man. Reverend Wilson. Man, we ain't heard, if you ain't known, Reverend Wilson, you know, he was taking care of some business.
Pastor Wilson?
So we won't give him that much respect?
Yeah,
Pastor Wilson? Okay. And you know, he was taking care of a young lady. They were supposed to be having prayer, and it just ended up more prayer. This is the reason why people don't want to go to church, man. And nobody trusts nobody. And again, the first thing people say, oh, he human, this and that. Again, all right, but I'm a teacher, though, and I put myself in a certain situation. There's a certain level of behavior that I got to display. Same thing with the man of God. Man of God.
But he's still a man. We had this conversation before. The king said the same thing. He's still a man. Right. And I'm not going to say he didn't know the video was being taken place, but it got out there. Right. So behind closed doors, he going to still do the things that's going to satisfy him. You can't fault him for that.
True.
Even though he is a pastor.
Yeah, I mean, still a man, but the Bible does say, I suffer not many of us to teach because you will be held at a high standard. So,
and that's my issue.
Six in one hand, half a dozen in the other. I mean, to me, it's all how you look at it. I mean, because they also tell you, he who is without sin cast the first stone.
True.
So,
So here's my deal. Let's say he caught up in the moment. He's a human, like we're like y'all saying. He's a man. The man looks back at the camera, then goes back and continues his activity. First of all, there's no remorse in that. They like, he's like, oh man, you know, I'm caught up.
You don't know if this was a video that was made for his enjoyment and her enjoyment. He didn't know he was going to hit the social media like that. He didn't know he was going to go viral.
He's married, freak. Did that justify anything, man?
He's still a man. He did not know he was going to go viral. He did not know he was going to go into social media network.
I can't give him a pass, man. I'm sorry. I guess because I'm sick of it, I have a disdain right now for preachers. I really do.
Me and my buddy Alan G just talk about this all the time.
Yeah, and this just adds more fuel to that fire, and you know, and the complaint how people's like, you know, to me it's just become more financial, more of a business, and more entertainment, you know, it's just, and that's just how I feel about it.
That's why you got to know and be on the lookout for certain things, you know, and when someone tells you about sowing a seed of $100 and prosperity doesn't necessarily come in financial gains. It could be happiness, it could be, I mean, it could be anything. It doesn't, so that right there is a red flag. But if you continue to put yourself in a situation, you get what you go for.
But that ain't gonna bring the people in. If you tell them you tithe an offer, you'll be blessed.
Oh, it's gonna bring the people
with prosperity.
It's gonna bring more women.
Right, but there's other blessings that you can get. You can get insight, revelation. You can get blessed spiritually.
But that's a whole. That could be a whole another show.
Right.
We're gonna step away right now. When we come back, again, like I said, we'll have some very special guests. We'll be back in a short period. we are live back live, and we have a special guest. Just like I promised you, we got several special guests. But our first guest is Mr. Shawn Arthur.
Can I say something?
Go ahead, man.
Hey, I'm with all our guests, man. I'm more than pleased to have him on. But this young man here, he's done more than a lot for me. And a lot of people that know me and know his relationship, you know, they know us as brothers, and that's how we present ourselves. There ain't no best friend, anything like that. He done things for my family, done things for my mother, done things for my grandmother, done things for my uncle, done things for my brother. Gave me the harsh reality of life. He don't sugarcoat anything. There's been time I cried on his shoulders, been time I needed money from him, brought me home, and stuff like that. So I would like to say to you, man, I really appreciate it. I'm about to get teary-eyed down. I really appreciate it. I love you. I can't tell you how much I love you. We done fought. And I mean, he's just done a lot for me. I mean, followed me through my collegiate career, followed me through my professional career, taught me how to manage money, taught me how to deal with people, helped me in my relationships, helped me in my marriage. And I can't say enough, man. I can go on and on about this guy.
Well, and I'm sure he appreciate that. I know he don't want you to take up all his time. Mr. Arthur, give us, man, your resume. We're not here to pry, and as like we said before, the title of the show is My Life, you know, My Redemption. You know, guys who turned their lives around and now making, you know, a positive impact in the community. So, you know, I'll let you speak on what you want to speak on.
Well, one thing about it is my life has always been an open book. And that's how I deal with my kids. That's how I deal with my friends. That's how I deal with everybody. I'm who I am.
Okay.
I don't change.
Yeah.
And anybody that know me know that I don't change. I mean what I say what I mean. You know what I'm saying? And of course, like, with Otis, it wasn't just Otis, it was a whole community. But at the time, you at the age of 12 years old, you're not understanding the things and the power that God has given you and seeing what he is doing to move you due to the fact that a lot of young men was brought up with our fathers. So with that being said, when we grew up, we had each other. And you don't see that in the schools and the neighborhoods or nowhere else these days. So therefore, it was bestowed upon me. When we went anywhere, I was in control.
Right.
I had to make sure a crowd of 15 young men, everybody gets home. I would be the last one to go home because I was responsible for these guys. And it carried on through their life to where when I decided to go astray, they weren't able to go due to the fact that I made sure that this ain't the life that you guys want. You know what I'm saying?
So those 15 guys, were you saying this when you was young, Shawn?
Yes.
And you was, these were just guys that was just following you? Like, this was before you got into the life. Okay. And
right.
So when you got into that life, they still followed.
That's they tried.
They tried to. And then you was like, nah, you don't need to go there.
Right.
So you've been doing this.
Right.
Basically.
You've been doing this.
So basically, you just took a curve and then came back.
Man, taking a curve, you know, it's just like dipping off on this side, okay? They want to go on this side, no, you can't go on that side. You know what I'm saying? It's like a forbidden place for these young men because this, it can change your life like it did mine.
That is so rare to find somebody as, like say, the leader of whatever little group, whether it's a gang or whatever. 9 times out of 10, they don't have that type of heart to actually look out for their guys. It's more of a greedy selfishness, like, hey, if I'm going down crabbing a bucket mentality, but you looking at this guy like, oh man, you need to go this way from the jump. They didn't take you until you got wise and older. You was like that from the beginning. And that's just interesting though, but go ahead.
Coming from a point to where I grew up there, but my mother went to school, worked at night, got an education, got a better job, and moved us out. So that's when I became more friends with these young men. And we was all friends. But being that I was the biggest, the strongest, you know what I'm saying, I had maybe a year or two on some of these guys, it made me the elder, and that's how the village used to be. You know what I'm saying? The elders would always be in control, and we still had that order back then. Somewhere along the way, we have lost that. So, of course, you know, once you feel like you're responsible, I've been feeling like I'm responsible for these guys for life, and I have walked to walk with them through their life, like Otis, John, everybody. You know, when you see me, I'm the same person. You know, so no matter where you're from, it never was a where you're from thing.
Let me ask you this. Okay. So, we started here as you, as a, almost as a protector of them, because you protected their interests.
Right.
Okay, so now, you wanted them to stay on the straight and narrow. You took a step to where you went to. Now, from there, what brought you back?
Knowing it's a dead end and a waste of time. And I tell them all the time, not only them, my nephews, my cousins, everybody, you don't have to do that because I have done it for you guys. It's nothing but a waste of time.
That's what he always
said. Life is a lot shorter than what you think. So I can't go and let you invest your time into something that I know that can probably lead you either to the graveyard or to the jailhouse for the rest of your life.
Man, and you know that's it, kind of like what the legend was saying, man, that's, like you say, is rare. And I've said on here several times before about how many people that we know that we grew up with alone that's either dead or in jail behind someone else's idea. Mm-hmm. Whereas you took and you pushed them that way instead of pulling them.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? So, I mean, dude, you definitely have to be commended on that. And like I know now, you know, when we were trying to get the bachelor party together, I walked up on you at one of your businesses, and I know that you know, you have a couple of, you know, things that you're doing now. If you want to speak on them and, you know, put it out there, you know, what you're doing now.
Right. Well, more or less, you know, you hear a lot of people say the kids are our future.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, at some time in here, we have it to where we spend half our life, oh, I want this, I want this, you know what I'm saying? Being that Otis is in sports, oh, I want to be the best football player I can be. Being my trade was auto mechanics, okay? I want to do the same thing everybody else want to do. My dream is to be on Broadway, on the front street, you know what I'm saying? To where I can make a lot of money, I can do a lot of, you know, different things, you know, get with a lot of different people. Until finally, I sit there at my shop and I just think about everything that goes on at this particular place. Being that it's still in the urban community, the things that I do there, I couldn't do on Broadway because I wouldn't reach the right people. Every day I have kids walk by my shop with no clothes during the winter. I have to take it upon myself to, you know, get a bag of clothes. The next time they pass by there, I give them a coat. You know, the next time they pass by, I may give them a pair of pants. You know, I have grown-ups come through there, they hungry. You know what I'm saying? Homelessness. You know what I'm saying? And finally, I just figured out, selfish me, I want all these things, but God had me in this place to be able to give back out to the community that I took so much out of. You know what I'm saying? And once that I had that revelation that I have been richer in life than ever,
right
there where I'm at. You know, and a lot of people pass by there and look and they know it's not classic automotive, but it's, you know, it's Busy Bee Cab Company and Garage.
Right.
But at the same time, the things that we give there, the information, the camaraderie, you know, just everything, because you'd be surprised who come through there. You got judges, lawyers, you got everybody that come through there to speak to me, to get blessings about certain things.
Donation.
It really matters, you know, what my opinion is for whatever they may be doing. Whether it be kids coming by there, you know, with their parents, hey, you got to meet Mr. Crunchy, Mr. Crunchy did this,
bro. Right.
And so on, you know what I'm saying?
I got two questions for you, Shawn, before we run out of time.
Oh.
My first question is, how did you get the nickname Crunch? Second question is, I don't know if you remember this, man, but when I was in junior high school, we used to play a lot together as teammates. You were always you would pick me and you would look for me to shoot the ball. And you was older than me. And I felt like we bonded, freak. You know, I mean, I didn't really know Shawn. I mean, I knew you, you know, right. And it just goes back to what you were saying, how, you know, you was a protector and this and that, even at a young age. I just felt like we had a bond and you probably didn't know. But my thing is, once we got past that, and then, you know, you became Crunch later, and almost like a Suge Knight Galaxy. When was that particular moment, or was it a buildup of events that led you to the lifestyle?
Of course, it's always a buildup of events that lead you to that lifestyle. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And it's, you know, peer pressure is real. Mm-hmm. Peer pressure is real. You know what I'm saying? It's people that you love, you know, draws you into this game due to the fact that you don't want no part of it. But at the same time, they get involved and it draws you into it, so you have to be involved at time. But I believe that I was a good judge of what and how I want to be involved in certain things, and that would gave me a lot more passes through neighborhoods, you know, certain people, and notoriety with these certain people that, you know, normally say, oh, let's go down the 33rd Street, hey, he can't be there. Right. But he mentioned my name, he get a pass, and then they check it, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
And it's just, you know, like that.
Yeah.
And it was just a time, you know what I'm saying, that things were like that.
So your thing is the main thing was the peer pressure.
Just, oh, yeah, no doubt.
You, boys, you know, people that you...
I'm pretty sure some guys that you grew up with, you know, some of them done well, and some of them went astray.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And I tell kids this all the time. It'd be the people that you least expected. The ones that had all the nice stuff in school, the polo shirts, the all different color tennis shoes, they'd be the weakest ones.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because they have all these things, but the mental capacity they don't have to be able to cope with reality.
Right.
So we never got a chance to grow up. And when it comes that time for everybody to start trying to grow up, they have no experience at it.
Right.
Because their parents took so well of care of their wants and not their needs.
Right.
So now they suffer in their adult life.
It's just interesting though, Shawn, is that you protected your boys. You was the one that was like, bro, you don't need to do this, you don't need to do that. But at the same time, they was able to lure you in.
But it wasn't able to, when the boys able to lure me in. Let's go back. Family. Family.
Wow.
You see what I'm saying?
Let me ask you this. Was there anyone that did that for you? Was there any older guy, anybody that you looked up, who tried to step in and say, uh-oh.
So it was too late.
It was too late.
It was too late, and I looked like a grown ass man. So
yeah,
they wasn't trying to tell me nothing.
Right.
And see, it's interesting, like, you know, he's saying that, like, you know how we're talking about peer pressure, but I never saw that anybody peer pressure him, because he was always in control of what he wanted to do.
Right.
And like how he said in the different communities, and it's funny that he said that, yes, I was able to go through certain neighborhoods. Even though if I was over here or over there, it was my affiliation with him. Like, that's hands off.
But like you said, family, and you know, when it comes to family, that's a whole different
ballgame. And that's the only thing I could say, my mother, you know, God bless her soul, you know what I'm saying? She told me my whole story as it was going on. You think I don't know what you're doing, I know exactly what you're doing.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? And I'll never forget the first time she said crunchy. So it was like, ooh, light bulb, you know what I'm saying? Where did she get that from? And by the way, I didn't name you Crunchy. Your name is Shawn.
Real quick, how did you get Crunchy?
Real quick, how did I get Crunchy? When I was going around, man, I fought like probably people like to dance.
Breaking bones, crunch,
arms, everything. It got pretty brutal. You know what I'm saying? Because you can tell I probably was a freak of nature at the age of 12 to 15, you know what I'm saying? 190 pounds, number muscle. Zero tolerance.
Man, you know, man, that's funny, because I remember when I moved in, I got to Austin and you was there.
I was a teacher.
So, I'll never forget, man, the first time I met him, and we were playing off the wall, man, we was playing off, and you know, you drop, didn't catch the ball, together. Well, anyway, you touch the wire. Well, after I didn't touch the wire, he hit me with the ball anyway. So I picked it up and threw it back. I said, man, you crazy, man? You know what I said? Remember, he hit me with the ball. So we come find later, long story short, him and Patrice were late.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that was, you know, my boy. So the first thing when they did that, I said, well, I'm going to go get the big boy. But I know. Patrice was the same way. For the longest, for some reason, I thought you was his uncle, but with y'all cousins.
Baptiste,
yeah. And so, man, that was when I first met him, you know, just as move went to the school and everything. So, you know, like I said, when I first saw him, teach all them kids, because like you say, he was big. We were all, you know.
Hey. Before we go, let me give you a quick story. Me and Cedric Gonzalez used to run around, Speedy and Z. Well, Crunchy used to shake us down all the time. And we used to have home economics in the barracks. So we used to, I forget what our home ed teacher name was, but we used to always ask her, could we leave 5 minutes early? This is before bullying, people even know what bullying was. So she would always ask me and Cedric, is somebody bothering y'all? Well, we knew not to say his name, and we were like, nah, we just want to leave early so we can get to our next class early since we was way in the barracks. So he caught on to what we was doing and started waiting. We know we had north and south.
Right.
So he started waiting on us to see us cross the street. So me and Cedric got the idea that we're going to start splitting up. So then we started splitting up. So he caught on the wind of that. So we would always go to the bathroom to take our money out of our shoes to put back in our pocket. So he caught us one day. And me and Cedric ain't take the money out of our shoes. So he was like, I know where the money is. Give up the money. So with that being said, can we get our change?
That's why I said we bonded, because you got to pull with me, man. We made a connection on the
right. All right, man. But hey, with that being said, we're gonna step away, take a break, and after that, we'll be back with some more guests. And I'm hoping that you're enjoying the show. Like I said, this is something that you know you want to show your children, or if you know someone who's not where you feel they're supposed to be, then anything's possible, man. Anybody can you know, turn it around. So with that being said, we'll step away and we'll be right back.
Been the same old thing on my block. You either working or you slanging on my block. You had to hustle, cause that's how we was raised on my block.
Alright, we're back. Upper room. We have another special guest, like I promised you, we're going to have several of them. We have Mr. Eddie. Is it Eddie or Ever? I know you want me to call Eddie, but is it Eddie or Ever?
Ever?
Okay, that's where we're going to go. So we're going to go with Miss Eddie.
So you asked, you know what I'm saying, I prefer Eddie.
Yeah.
Because Edward is too formal.
Yeah, but we can be formal.
So we
all
formal.
Yeah, Ever. Man, it's a pleasure to have you, man. I've been knowing you for a very long time. And we ran into each other again several years ago. But, man, and then I heard that, you know, how you've turned things around. And then just a part of the conversation we had off camera, which, man, that may need to be a show within itself, because there was a lot of knowledge being passed around the room.
I'm with
that. Yeah. But without further ado, man, I'm gonna step away. I'm gonna let you again, like I told Shawn, give us speak on what you want to speak on, and we'll, as we move down the line, we'll throw some questions out to you.
Same thing. First of all, I want to let it be known, I'm a Yankee fan.
that's our show.
All right. Now, but the main thing I want to get across to everybody is, back when I was doing my thing, I thought all you see is all you do. Now, if I come outside and I see so-and-so got a flashy Cadillac, this guy right here got another Cadillac on some rims and some hose with the bang. I'm like, God damn, that's some fire. Man, all you see is all you do. Right. But that's a misconception.
Right.
I learned that down the years. Now, I remember distinctively in the eighth grade, my first period class was Miss Reese. And I go to Miss Reese one morning, I'm crying. She's like, babe, what you crying for? I'm like, Miss Reese, I don't know. She's like, baby, come outside, let me talk to you. And that's when I knew when it was. But I didn't know that then. It took me a long time. I went to the penitentiary for 11 years and some change.
Yeah.
And did some things on the streets that we can't talk about.
Right.
Oh yeah, we understand that.
And but I had to understand, what was the determining factor when you decided to do what you did? And I think in the eighth grade that year, that was my determining factor. And I could have played sports with you, Wes. You know? Man, I was damn good.
Oh yeah, you were.
I was damn good. And but all you see is all you do. And break it down from that aspect to whereas if I was on the other side of Broadway and my mama was a school teacher and my daddy was a bus driver, okay, well, 9 times out of 10, I'm gonna fall in the footsteps.
Right.
I'm gonna be either a bus driver or a school teacher, or I'm gonna go to school. Mm-hmm. But when I come outside my door in the streets of cemeteries, dirty dirt, fly ass Cadillac right there.
Yeah.
Man, I'm fucking nice, man. Get another fly ass Cadillac. I'm fucking nice too.
Right.
Man, I gotta get this money. They said it though.
Right.
Okay, so 9 times out of 10, in my scenario, I'm gonna fall in line, which I did. I wasn't strong enough as a young child to overcome, say, okay, well, let me look past that. I wasn't strong enough then, but now I am now.
Go ahead.
Was there anybody, did anybody try to deter you from that life? Did anybody pull you to the side like, Eddie, come on, man?
But before you answer that, and let's say, you know, we know you have, well, you're the youngest, right?
I mean, well,
my other boy.
German, yes.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
German, yeah, the I'm the youngest now.
Forgive me. I've got nerve. But, okay, and I know. As a matter of fact, Tim was with us. But Tyrone. Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, me and Tyrone became cool over the years, and I've always known Tyrone as, I'm not going to say, you know, straighten up, but I've always known him to get out, work, do this, do that. And that's where I'm going. So.
All right. To answer your question first. Coach Gia.
We are the Braves, man.
I used to play for the Braves. I was a catcher for the Braves. And Coach Gia would always tell me on some 5% knowledge or on some Islamic knowledge. Did not understand it then because my mama was Islamic at the same time back then. And then Coach Gia was the one that would always try to push me. Eddie, man, you can do it. You can do it. You can be the one. Now, to you, Wes, to understand what you're saying, is that, yeah, and then that goes back to all you see is all you do. And then that's why I say that's a misconception because Tyrone and my sister and my older brother did was raised in the same household as me, but they did not choose the path that I did. So, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, everything is a choice.
Right.
It's a choice. You know what I'm saying? Whatever you do, can you make that choice and be satisfied with that choice and live with that choice?
My question is, was it the fast money that deterred you away from using your athletic ability to play sports because you know you can get it fast, so you can take the time out and say, you know what, let me get on the field with Merv West and Owens and we're going to work out more, or shit, I'm looking to be on varsity, or was it a situation saying that, okay, we know peer pressure played a part. Whether it's family, whether it's friends and stuff like that.
Because from the previous guest, crunching, it was the peer pressure too.
Right.
Peer pressure is real.
Right. Oh, I do agree with that. But I mean, like, you had an outlet, you had a chance to play, just like all of us. And I'm not saying all of us is right, because, you know, we did our dirty as well. But you think it was the money? And my question being with that, because if, like you said, you see the cars, you see the rims, the jewelry, being able to travel and go here and being not limited, because I know my mom couldn't give me money to get shoes and stuff like that to be able to get it on your own. So you think, was it money the determining factor of you doing what you did in the past?
Yeah, we can say money was the main determining factor. But at the same time, we was conditioned to, from where you at, that you have to be a backup for this. You have to stand back for this. You have to have your back for this. Mm-hmm. So, man, these my niggas.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna back them up at all costs.
Right.
And I still have that mentality right now today. Mm-hmm. So what now changes me, or what motivates me now, is that if I can see anybody doing anything outside the realm, pull them to the side. At least I can tell them something.
Right.
Hey man, this is what I used to do. I used to do the same thing, bro. You're going down the wrong path.
And see, I think like in our society, like we having a lot of like reference to one of the kids that we both taught in school that got killed. And I think a lot of the kids, when it's the older guys going to tell them, they not trying to hear that. Or they may not know about you.
Right.
They may not know about a Crunchy. People that had a little power and a little weight. And now that you're not doing the same thing, why the hell I'm listening to you? Knowing that if it got down to that being disrespectful, yeah, we still can handle our own, but these young kids, they not listening to that. And you know, one time, you know, he told me at one time a long time ago, if it was still the same, I'd still be doing it. But it ain't the same no more. And then you got kids out there that's playing with these different colors, and I wish they would have got to meet guys like you and him saying, y'all run around here playing with different sets, but you really ain't about that color.
Dude, I can remember when we were in high school. I was freshman year, so I mean, I think you were still in Central.
No, I was in Daycare.
Yeah, so you were still in 8th grade. Remember, 1 week, every day, about a whole week, somebody got shot at school.
At school.
And then, no, we ain't talking about just that somebody we knew got shot. But I'm talking about every day.
That's why my parents sent in O'Connell just for what you did. We just made you immune to death. Man, y'all know the Rockets lost, and then such and such died. It was just regular conversation. Right. I remember that, Wes.
Yeah, it was, and you know, so like when you go other places, and you meet people, and I would, you know, tell them, you know, I'm like, oh man, you know, they're a baby Compton down there. and this and that all. When they found out that, you know, what we thought was, no, we had police patrolling on horseback.
No, we had police at our school.
That's what I'm saying, patrolling on horseback.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, everybody else just had security guards, and we thought this is what it was supposed to be.
Right.
And so now, and I don't mean to cut you, it'll take a bunch of time, so now we know why they're doing what they're doing. They've done, they're cleaning it up. But anyway, back to you know what's good. So now, many guys, you said you did 11 years.
Yes.
Many guys get out, they come home, they struggle to get back inside, and they find themselves doing the same thing. What deterred you from doing that? What made you go?
After my second bid, I'm like, man, this bullshit right here. I know I'm smarter than this. And I was reading and learning and I was listening. Keep on listening to everything that goes on inside them blocks. So I'm like, okay, well, this gonna be my mentality right here. And I wrote it down on paper. And my last quote right on that end page was, I'd rather be broke living under a bridge than come back and heal it. And that was my self-motivation right there. And now here I am working in the plant. I ain't got a whole lot, but I got enough. I got enough to sustain me. I'm good.
Yeah,
I'm not trying to be flashy. Now I ain't gotta look over my shoulder no more. I ain't gotta worry about somebody coming into my house because, oh man, he got that ghetto in there. Man. Well, he got that grass or he got that bread. I ain't got.
Or when you get pulled over, license and insurance.
Yeah. Here you go, sir.
Yeah.
And I know the protocol.
Not being afraid to stop at a stoplight and police running on next to you.
It's crazy that you say police get pulled over because young black people are dying just from bullet shots, man, from these pump beats, man. Yeah. Like, so I know the protocol. And then when they pull up my manual and it pop up on that screen, oh yeah, my whole history pull up. So I'm this. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. No, sir. Yes, sir. I ain't no punk in there, but I'm gonna respect that gun.
Yeah, you got to.
I'm gonna respect
if you
that
wanna
gun.
Go home.
Yes, sir.
The thing that makes you unique, Eddie, and just going back to your athletic ability, you know, I mean, you played together,
yes,
won the championship together,
yes,
in baseball.
Yes, sir.
You was a running back for the Patriots. I mean, you
yes,
was a hell of an athlete, man. What makes this thing so unique is that most kids, when they get into gangs or the street life, these are kids with low self-esteem. They followers. They probably can't play no ball. So they're trying to find something to identify themselves with. They probably, a lot of them probably can't fight, so they get involved in situations.
Right. Or follow the oldest.
Right. Right. Right.
But like he just said, his three older siblings didn't do that. Yeah. Right. He went there.
But here comes Eddie.
So I know where you're going.
Hell of a running back. State champion. And it's still that pressure, that lure was so strong to where you can take that life and put it to the side and still pursue that life. And I guess what could we tell these kids? Because we have kids in that situation, you know, but what could you tell them, though, to make them not go that way? I mean,
what could you tell the next ever did?
The main thing I try to instill in anybody that comes under me now is, man, what you fighting for? What's your main goal? You gotta have some type of purpose. And it's all about your heart. It's all about your heart. And don't be a follower. Set the rules for on the table for your own self.
Right. And I think a lot of kids not doing that. And I have another question. You know, I grew up in 24cc too. But you know, I was always on 43rd or 35th. Do you think sometimes the environment that you grew up in, you already labeled as being that type of gang member from that area?
Of course.
Because you can have a kid that grows up in I'm going to give a prime example, Tim Dent.
Right.
He didn't gang bang, but he was affiliated because
yes.
He stayed in that area.
Right.
So a lot of times, and not that he went through any problems, any trouble, but if you had a rival gang that passed by and they just got into it with you and I, they'll probably take it out on him just because he's from that area. So I think kids have to deal with that as well.
Right.
And you know, a lot of us that grew up in the ghettos, we didn't have to be affiliated with that gang, but they affiliated us with
mm-hmm.
that gang.
And then on that aspect, what I think about growing up in the projects is that we were so close knit with everybody at that particular time. You know, I can come outside of my house and I can see Molly house. I can see Tim Denton grandma house right there.
Mm-hmm.
I can see Willow house. I can see Chris house. You know, and so we was right there with each other. You know, I didn't have to go 15 blocks and meet my best friend.
Because they was right there.
It was right there. And that's what I think a lot of these kids nowadays, you know, they meeting each other at school. Now, once they leave school, I don't have no affiliation with you no more.
Let me ask you.
They're not becoming friends.
Let me ask you. This is a question that I've been having, and I just guess I hadn't run across the right person. Where do we go wrong? And when I say that, Galveston, small city, what, 50, 55?
37.
Okay.
40,000.
I'm talking about when we were there.
Oh,
it was
okay.
There. 55, 60,000. Where did that lifestyle take over? Because think about it. The guys that were banging against one another, we grew up together.
Yeah.
We went to the same school. We played together. So we let. Was it a movie?
For me, myself, the year was 1988. Yeah, that's when we come together.
When I was strong.
Right.
Okay.
Right. So, but we was already, you know what I'm saying, feuding with them other neighborhoods anyway, whether it be a baseball game, whether it be a football game, whether it be a basketball game. We was competitive individuals.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So 1988, when the movie dropped and everybody chose a side, okay, well, so we still gonna be competitive. Okay, now it chose from the basketball to knives, baseball to guns, mm-hmm. and football to drugs.
Mm-hmm. You know what? I would take that a step further. I would say the breakdance groups were first, then it went to sports, and then it went to gangs. Because when they, what we broke
still
up,
had John
the they were competing at the dances, and yeah. sometimes ended up in a fight or whatever.
but it was a fight.
Yeah,
right. And everybody went on, yeah. and a couple days later, you see the dudes that was fighting. Right. You'll see them together. Right. Cause you know what I'm saying? You would see them older guys like that. They would get into a fight at a dance. You know, we in middle school, and then we see them 2-3 days later. Two dudes were fighting. Then they chasing us on. You know what I'm saying? Right. So and that's just what it was.
I never understood how with seven blocks.
Mm-hmm. Pretty much.
Seven blocks between the neighborhood blocks. That you had so much trauma, violence, killings, but we can go to a football game rooting on the same school, ball high, we cool, leave out the stadium, now we shooting and fighting. Mm-hmm. Or we can go to Lamar and I can be a blood or a crib.
Yeah.
But he may see me fighting, but he gonna help me when we get back home.
Yeah.
We ain't cool.
Take you over even further. You had some of these guys playing on the same team.
Yeah.
He probably had some blocking for it.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Right. So to me, we were just too small of a place for that, and that's why it was as bad as it was, because it was nowhere to hide. Right. Listen, you go in Houston somewhere, you get into it with somebody, you'll never see them again.
You go, you do something on the north side, you go west, yeah. south, west side.
Exactly. But me and him get into it, and we got.
We gonna see each other.
We had the same school. Probably little close.
But on the ending note, man, my main concern is to get my point across is all you see is all you do is really some bullshit. Because you can change any opportunity as long as you have breath in you.
Yeah.
You can change your opportunity. You can change it.
But do you ever think with our young kids and our generation today who's trying to follow the lead of their uncles or their past relatives and stuff like that it will stop? Because I still see some of our older guys still pushing.
Yeah.
Still wearing the blue. Still wearing the red. Or go to parties and they, as y'all would say, like the sit-off dummies. You can get this little cat to see if he's gonna really go fight this kid and stuff like that, but now it's escalating even more. And even though little junior or little senior get into a fight, the bigger guy is really taking the publicity of it.
Well, from my perspective on that too, is that all you can do is teach yours on the individual level and respect that. Whatever you give them, eventually they're gonna get it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Just give it to them. Give it to them. Whatever kind of knowledge, man, that you got, give it to them. Just like our parents gave it to us. You know, did they drill it into us? Yes, back then they did. You know, can we drill it into ours now? And we gotta be a little more passive. When why would I be passive? I'm not passive. I'm gonna drill it into mine.
Hopefully
they'll get it.
I think the best education some of these kids could get, if they would bring guys like yourself and a Crunchy into the schools and talk to these kids that's been through it. Yeah, you can have counselors, you can have probation officers, you can have police officers that come in, but you know, kids are blow that off.
Yeah.
But when they got the actual individual that been through it and telling these kids what you doing, what you wearing, you really ain't about their life. Because once you go behind them brick walls, you're by yourself.
Yes, sir.
Unless you're gonna be somebody else.
Yes, sir.
Whatever, yes, inside sir. Of that. And then, even just because you wearing this red and you wearing that blue, you got that red and that blue, and that's gonna test you about that.
There's another factor that we don't talk about is, as a community, as a people, we glorify that lifestyle.
Oh, yeah.
Even the ones that's not a part of it. And we actually benefit from those guys putting in dirt, because then we leave Galveston, and what's the first thing we say? Oh, I'm from Galveston.
Yep.
Because you want that type of respect, right. But you ain't paying the price to get that. You riding off somebody else's back and you point your fingers at them and you're looking down on them at the same time. You glorify the lifestyle and you benefit from that so you can get a little respect. And I think that happens across the board.
we as a people, as a community, we have to be consistent and don't glorify the entire lifestyle.
That being said, man, give the viewers, really the kids, because that's who I really would like for this reason. Give them something. Give them a gem before we go to break here.
The gem is, and I'm going to throw up an avenue for you guys. As long as you're breathing, you can change your situation.
There it is. All right, we're going to go to break. We'll be back shortly. We have another guest. Don't want to miss it. Like I said, man, this is very educational. You don't get this just anywhere, you know. And you know, a lot of times, you know, people that you know like that, you're probably scared to approach them. But here they are giving you what they've been through and what they did to change. So with that being said, we'll step away and we'll be right back.
Been pimping in the south, you know how it go. We drive old school white walls with me flow. I spend the G unit piece.
Alright, let me be back live up the room. Like I said, we have several special guests. We're not quite done. We have another with here, Mr. Archie Williams. Texting stuff on, hurt my eyes even look at it.
Yeah, we starting off on a good foot,
It could be worse. It could be Dallas Cowboys.
Ooh, so,
but anyway,
can I give a little introduction?
Go ahead, man.
Bring him out. This guy here, man, I met over probably 10 years ago, and I had started a company called National Scholar Service. I was freshly started off. It's a service that's helping kids that don't get a lot of recruiting and notice. So I started that company. I started behind my daughter, and then I ended up meeting him through a relationship, which was his cousin. And Archie is really he's big on the basketball circuit. He was a legend himself in basketball, but I haven't seen no videos of it. But anyway, and he's the director over my basketball operations. He's a mentor in the community. He's from the Wicked City, which is Dickinson. He's a mentor, he's a father, and an educator as well. So this is Mr. Archie Williams. I'm glad to have him on the show, and he's like a brother to me as well.
Appreciate
you. All right, man, like I've told the past guest, man, we're not going to do any digging. We'll let you, tell what you want to tell. Tell us a story, your story, and then, you know, as you go on, we'll kind of throw in a few questions here and there. So, you know, you can go ahead and give us a resume, let everybody know who you are.
Well, I grew up in Dickinson. My daddy was a hustler, had a pimp. My mom was the hard worker of the family. She done janitorial engineering for over 30 years, you know what I'm saying? And she's the backbone of the family.
Yeah.
And so my dad was out there doing his thing, and we all went to school, graduated, I went to play a little college basketball, came back, because it was more about basketball and girls instead of education at the time. So long story short, while I was going to barber school, you know, I had to get back and forth to Houston, back and forth, wasn't really working. So my dad introduced me to the game, you know what I'm saying? Put that in my hand and a custom at the same time. Now I regret it now for it, you know what I'm saying? But at the time, that was the area we was in, you know what I'm saying? Hustling and doing that thing type of thing, so I kind of got away from basketball. And then, long story short, when I had my son, life changed. Archie Jr. came. And I always said I'd never have another dude laying next to my old lady making my son call him daddy. Went cold turkey. Most of them told me you can't do it. Just like that, when I had my son, life was over for his hustling. So then I went in the barbershop about 16 years. I was married, daughter, son, wife came. I was like, look, I need to go back to school. I'm telling my kids, go get education, make good grades. But here I am, I'm a ball, no education, no formal education besides high school. So she agreed to let me go back to school, got my bachelor of science in sociology, got in the educational field, taught a few years, special ed certified, you know, started a basketball league in Dickinson because I always thought it was about the kids. Now, I didn't know that was gonna be my calling, but I couldn't argue with God up top either.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So he put me in that situation. Still in the educational field now, I do what they call administrative security at Dickinson High School after the Santa Fe shooting.
They hired a whole nother group of guys to come in and do security, field work around the campus, check doors, make sure students are doing what they're supposed to do, you know, keep an eye on certain students if that's the case, and well-being or whatever the case may be. So, for the most part, I had dreams and aspirations and goals, but life changes when you grow up in the hood. And like Mr. Eddie said, you see it, you do it. You are a product of your environment. And my dad, he just, I still say Frank Lucas of Galveston County, you know what I'm saying? Right. The fancy cars, the feather hats, $2,000 suits, the Mr. T kit. I grew up with all that, but we still was poor. You understand what I'm saying? We're poor financially. He had all the money, all the gold, all the jewelry, the custom Cadillacs with the fifth wheel. You understand what I'm saying? Right. Trap houses before trap houses, he murdered. You know what I'm saying? I'm seeing things y'all wouldn't even understand. And so I had to live with that. But I wouldn't allow my kids to be a part of that. I didn't share for their life, but they couldn't do that either. You understand what I'm saying? I gave them a different way of living and exposed them to some different things, traveling around the country with sports, and come home with beach lives on camera. But they were my investment.
You said your father was the one that got you into the game.
Oh, most definitely. Yeah.
He taught you. Uh-huh. He taught you all the ins and outs. But your mother was a hard worker.
Very hard worker.
She wasn't a part of that.
No, sir.
How did that dynamic work? Because you got one-on-one in that's obviously leading you into the wrong path. But was your mom ever in your ear saying, baby, don't do what your daddy is teaching you?
She always said, don't do what your daddy is doing. But, you know, growing up as a man, you have to figure out to do certain things to make it. You know what I'm saying? Mama going to work, paying the bills, but that's it. Mm-hmm. The bills are paid. Ain't no extras. Right. So you out there looking around and seeing, I got the best of what everybody thinking, looking from the outside in. Mm-hmm. But life just is a little different when it's reality. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so I had to go get it the best way I knew how. If I wanted to make it.
So that's totally different from a regular kid dealing with peer pressure. That's coming straight from your daddy. How do you
say no?
I mean, that's your dad. Exactly. that's your homeboy.
Right.
That ain't, you see a bunch of guys with big Cadillacs and this is your dad.
That's the same thing like our first guest said, like with Crunchy. He was saying that it wasn't necessarily peer pressure from friends, it's family.
That's rough.
You know, and that was just the way of life for me at that particular. Now my brother, both of them, we lived in the same household. They ain't do none of that. Ain't never done none of that even close to that. Both of them hard workers doing their thing. I'm the youngest though. You understand what I'm saying? So like Guitry, he was the youngest.
Were you attracted to it? Did you just go to your dad and be like, man, you know, teach me that? And he taught
no,
you.
I was going to my dad every week to get gas money so I could get the barber store.
So
one week he just said, look, sir.
I can show you how to make this money.
Hello, I'm going to give you this and I'm going to give you that. He gave the customer and the business. He said, this guy going to meet you every day when you get home from ball school.
But you didn't have a problem when it was time to shut it down when your child was born.
Oh, zero.
Because there was something already inside you. You are
that really wasn't me. I knew that wasn't me. But I had to do what I had to do at the time to get where I need to be. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So when it came to the Archie Jr., that's a zero. That's a done deal. He don't know nothing about that life. You know what I'm saying? He don't know that daddy. Now he getting pieces of it now because I tell him the stories. I really want him to know who I really was back then opposed to the daddy he has now. You know what
and,
I'm saying?
You know, and that's hard for when you have a child that don't know anything about that. But you know, as Mr. Williams said, you don't hear it from me. You ain't got to hear it from nobody else.
Right.
I'm going to tell you.
I'm going to tell it to you. Not in the railway down the road because he's going to give you a bad information situation. I'm going to give you the uncut, raw version of it. You know what I'm saying? And so that's just, you know, the life of growing up in the hood in the old 70s, 80s. You know, when dope became prevalent, that's what it was. Most kids journeyed into that life, you know what I'm saying? At some point in their life.
So you didn't get involved because you needed the money, because obviously y'all was okay.
Your mom had
a job.
Yes.
Obviously your daddy bringing in good
yes.
money.
So no, yes.
It wasn't a situation where it was survival. It was just, you knew how to do it.
I better
talk the right way about how to do it. And so,
I'm going to do it big and I'm going to do it right. Supposedly.
And I still say I was blessed, not lucky, not to go to jail. Not to go to prison. Because all my partners did.
Well, probably because you was taught the right way.
Well, I was taught the right way.
Well, it's not the right way.
But it's not
the
right way. It is the right way. It's the right way to do work.
We don't want our views.
Right. Right. Right.
Right.
Right.
Right.
Right.
Right.
Right.
That's true.
didn't get to ask the pass to. So let me ask you this, not to pry too much.
Go ahead.
When you were going down that road, were you doing okay for yourself?
Yes, I was
doing okay. So now, you said that once you gave it up, there were some hard times, right?
Oh yeah, most definitely. Because that life supersedes you,
so
to get you things.
I know. So was it ever a lure to come back?
No.
No.
Once I quit, it was over.
That was it.
But yeah, it was it. Because I already knew, like I said, all my partners went to prison. Okay. All of them. Not one, two, all of them.
You didn't have to pay the ultimate price.
Exactly.
You learned from other people's mistakes.
Yes. And that was the thing. I didn't hustle to be the man. I hustle to survive, to get housing, cars, provide.
If you don't get into the game, that is the appropriate way of doing it. That's like the best way of doing
it. Is it the appropriate way?
No, I don't know.
Quit saying that. That ain't the appropriate way.
But the point is that he was educated on it, man. And he already knew the ins and outs. He didn't have to pay a big price for him to get it. On our past guest, remember, he spent 11 years. Then in prison, the light bulb came on. Light bulb didn't have to come on for him.
But see, I'm like the king. I'm gonna ask this question and allegedly say what you have, because we don't need the IRS or the government coming in there, because it can be a lie. But what's the most money that you had presently, allegedly, that you had?
Probably about $75,000 to $80,000. With work, some with cash.
Yeah. Because I know. Well, guess that I wanted to come on the show besides my brother. Allegedly, I just seen like $150,000.
Cash. Straight on the table.
I've seen more than that.
Damn.
Yeah. Cash. I've seen $500,000 cash. Woo! In a dresser drawer.
Yeah, I mean, so.
Allegedly.
Yeah.
Allegedly. Yes.
And see, so with that, and with, because when you think about it, you said $150,000. You know, yeah, that's about what you know, made in a year. So you know when you hear that one of your people are making a cut, money, oh man, he's doing good. Right. Then you got somebody who's sitting up here, he can pull this in a month or whatever. So that's what I'm saying, the lure, and that's tax free. $150,000, I'm probably getting out of that. So that, I mean, don't get me wrong, man, in no way am I glorifying.
You have to start measuring the risk reward
situation. Yeah, I'm not glorifying, but
it's just don't start measuring the risk.
You do.
That 150 is 150.
You start thinking like,
man. It ain't no 401, ain't no insurance taken out. No federal tax, none of that's taken out. That's $150,000. And so that's why my question was it a lure to go back?
No, sir.
And because now listen, we all know that the more money you make, you find a way to spend that extra money that's coming in.
Oh, yeah.
And if you're married, you got kids, you don't, they win. Never right or wrong.
So now you're buying the cars, the jewelry, the watches, taking trips.
It's unnecessary spending unless you just ridiculously disciplined.
So it's crazy because when you start thinking about guys who have, like you said, your dad had these Cadillacs. When you start thinking about guys who got 4 or 5 cars, you only drive what? I got 3 cars. I struggle to drive 2. I'm driving my car today just because I want to drive, because I ain't drove it in months. You know?
So why do you need all the cars?
Exactly.
But what got me though, you can see the guys with the money and they living the life of the lifestyle with the cars and the jewelry, but they ain't staying in a nice house.
Nah, I'm talking to you, they not.
So what's the end game? Is you trying to get it? I know back then we weren't thinking
because their priorities are not right. It's all about Air Jordans and Cavs.
Well, yeah, you talking about the wrong guys. You talking about the wrong guys. There are some guys that are living in houses.
We're talking about the bigger guys. Well, they're the main focus who you get to work from, because they're not out there doing. They got to push it.
Nah.
Well,
they're not front lines.
Yeah.
So is no Lord to go back?
No, sir.
The adjustment, because evidently you had to make an adjustment on your lifestyle, how you live, in the thing that you bought, you know. So what was that like?
It was a big adjustment. But I became more financial savvy too. To live in a certain area of lifestyle by the finances I was making, legitimately doing, you know, working. And my wife has been educated for 24 years. She's been the backbone like my mom was for my family. That's what she is for.
Hey, sis, and she don't play.
Yeah, exactly. So you know what I'm saying? So I made an investment with them, and so I owe them. So I owe those three still today. My wife, my daughter, and my son.
In my next life, man, if I want to be a dope deal, I'm going to do it.
God damn it, man.
with that being said, we still got more of the show to come. We're going to step away. We're going to step away for a few minutes, God, then we'll be back with our next.
Hey, we need calls. Call in.
Alright, we back. Open room. Like I said, we had several special guests. We are back now with another special guest, Steven Wells. We all went to school together, class of 91, greatest class of Waffles, House of Waffles.
Say it again.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, for a couple of people in the audience,
yes,
but
watching that.
Man, you know, like I say, man, we all go way back.
Way back.
And you know, this one is just a little bit different from all the other ones, because, you know, like I said, we went class together, we played football together, ran track together, basketball, and everything else. And so, with that being said, man, we're going to kind of step out. Like we told her, we're not going to pry into anything. So whatever it is you want to say, you can say. We'll have a few questions. If you feel like you don't want to answer,
no problem.
Then we'll move on.
All right. Well, first of all, I'm very glad to be here, man. I'm liking the show. It's still going to blow up. I really see this here, man. I really like what y'all doing.
Appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you. Yes, Edmond Wells, Sr., born and raised in Galveston, father of four, class of 91 graduate. Married now, man. Grew up, I'm not gonna say rough. I had a decent childhood. My grandmother and my mother raised me well. When after high school, I made the wrong choices. I'm not gonna blame nobody, you know, or use an escape goat for the choices I made. You know, end up going to prison a few times, three times to be exact. Once for drugs, twice for a gun. I stopped my life of crime straight up, because I've been hard-headed all my life. When I got shot at 44, I was shot in the side and in the back, paralyzed from the waist down. I was told I would never walk again. But through the grace of God and a strong wife and
a lot
of praying and, you know, friends and family pushing me, coming to see me, checking on me, hey, man.
Yeah.
Man, this really gave me hope.
Now, at 44, so that was about 2 years ago.
Yeah,
man, it's going to 3 years. Okay, and it's strange that you say that. I can't think of the restaurant name, but I was sitting in there with one of my homeboys. We sitting in there, and your little brother walked in.
Which one? Here?
Yeah. And I didn't know who he was at the time. I heard somebody say, "Wes." And I kind of looked around. He said, "Man, what's going on?" I said, "What's up, man?" And I didn't even know his name at the time. I called him Lil Nut. Mm-hmm. So he's like, "You know, you can find that man, Eric, man." So I said, "Man, how's your brother doing?" And he was like, "He got nothing." He said, "Man, you didn't hear what happened?" And he told him about, he told him about what happened. I think at the time, you were still in the hospital.
Yeah.
I guess we really don't have to ask what made you make that change.
Being told you never walk again was a wake-up call. I mean, after I got shot and came out of the coma and everything, me being hard-headed thinking I'm all right before they told me I was paralyzed, first thing on my mind, revenge. because I don't know how to forgive. I still have a problem with forgiveness right now.
Yeah, that sounds like somebody at the table.
And I'm working on it. I mean, I'm a work in progress, man, just like we all are.
Sometimes. Yeah, there you go, work in progress.
Everybody work in progress in their own way, man. So, you know, like I say, my first thought was revenge. I wasn't trying to hear nothing else, nothing my family was talking about when he was like, boy, you paralyzed from the waist down, you're gonna be like this the rest of your life.
Wow.
It hit me,
wow.
But then it didn't hit me. But I'm gonna tell you the funny thing, though. When I was laying there, my family, my fiance at the time, she's my wife now, my family, my wife, my aunt, my brothers, we all just sitting around here, everybody crying. I'm like, y'all say I'm paralyzed, but my legs itch. You're like, man, you can't feel your legs. They said, that's just the nerves, John. I say, man, my legs itch. And I move my legs. I mean, do that again. So I did it again. The nurse, well, she was in there at the time as well. And she said, do that again. So she pulled the covers back. And I lift my left leg, and they made my family get out, brought all the doctors in, a team of doctors in, and they got the, can you do that again? Can you let your leg down? I couldn't let it down, so they pulled it down for me. And then I lifted again. I couldn't lift my right, couldn't do nothing on my right side. And I got shot on the left side, which was crazy. It was like the right side was all messed up. And the doctors told me, can you wiggle your feet? I couldn't wiggle my feet, but I could only move my left leg. Then a few days later, my right leg started, it just, you know, started jumping. The nerves started jumping. And, you know, they ended up transferring me from a hospital in San Antonio because I got shot in San Antonio. And they transferred me to a Bay Area Rehabilitation Hospital. It's called PAM now, Post Acute Medical. It's in Webster, Texas. Damn good place to go to rehabilitation. But they talk about tear and all that, that's the place to be. But anyway, not to give nobody no free advertisement. when they transferred me there, I had two doctors tell me, oh man, you're gonna need braces to walk again and this and that. And I was like, man, every day I feel like my legs are, they not jumping and moving for no reason. I think I can walk. They're like, well, stand you up, you're gonna fall down. Well, stand me up, let me fall, I need to see. Yeah. Well, no, you still got the rods in your back. So when I got shot, I didn't know they removed my spleen, my left lung, I got two metal rods in my back with 10 screws, 5 on each side. The bullet hit me, it went through my left lung, shattered 2 ribs, left lung, hit the kidney, shattered my T11, T12 vertebrae. The other bullet hit my diaphragm and my other kidney. It came through my diaphragm and launched in my bladder. I still have a bullet in my bladder right now today.
Damn, bro.
Yeah, they got one out and the other one still launched in.
It's funny that, you know, he talking about when his family came up. I don't know where I got the news from. It was from my brother, and I hit you on Facebook Messenger, and you hit me back because I had a different number.
Yeah.
But I go up to see him, walk in the, his room, he laying in the bed, and I had tears in my eyes. And the first thing he said, like, Zeke, what you crying for? I ain't going to be here forever. He said, I'm going to walk. You remember that?
My goodness.
So at that time, I told him, I was like, bro, when is it going to stop? And he was like, Zeke, I'm done, man.
Yeah.
But me and him go way back. I remember we was on 103rd in high school. Was it my senior?
I was senior.
I'm getting ready to sign, but you know I didn't get to sign on National Day with Weston because I didn't pass the SAT at the time. But we go to a party on the 103rd.
Yeah.
Altercation breaks out. You know me, known for having a gun. So I bust off the gun. And my guy right here took the gun and said, Zeke, you can't be doing it, man. You gotta go to school. Give me that gun. And took the gun. Remember that?
Yeah, I remember that. Then I started busting.
Allegedly.
Yeah. But, man, you see, so this is the type of thing, like, you know, we're trying to get this, what this young man has been through in. What God has done in helping him get back to, damn, a coma, being told you could never walk again, man. And I mean, you know, he walked in and, you know, and yeah, that just to hear what he's saying and then to see him walk through that door, that's amazing.
That's a girl.
Yeah, that's a story in itself.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Now, at 44, you got shot. Up all the way from high school up until that point, you was in that life. Was there any other situation that kind of made you think, damn, I need to stop?
To be honest, the second trip to prison, yeah, that was a wake-up call, because I did more time that time.
But you went back, though.
Yeah, I had to go, yeah.
No, you went back to the lifestyle. You didn't learn.
Yeah, but yeah, the second time, even though it wasn't for drugs, I was still in that life. You know what I'm saying? They came looking for drugs, didn't find no drugs, they found a pistol. So I had to fade the heat for that.
The probation violation.
Now, I was out of paper. I was a whole new charge. So they ended up giving me 7 years for that. Done right at 3.5, but man, that was a wake up call because it could have been worse. What if they would have found the note?
Were you married? Did you have any children?
No, I had 4 kids at the time.
Yeah, 4 kids at the time.
But you weren't married?
No, I wasn't married. Wasn't married.
Man, you know, because after you have children, a lot of times that's enough motivation for you to stop that, because now it's not about Edmond, it's about my 4 children.
True.
That still wasn't enough, though.
To be honest, I know I'm a good father. My kids can vouch for me as a good father. Hopefully their mothers will without any other animosity.
Right.
But I use hustling as an escape goal. Not to want to work, man. Straight up, I ain't gonna lie to you.
Okay.
So you weren't using that avenue like to try to take care of your kids or?
No, that's what I was using that avenue for. Right. For just hustling. I was making it. You know what I'm saying? I was doing it.
But you didn't want to punch a clock.
I didn't what?
You didn't want to punch a clock.
Every now and then, if I fall on my tail, okay, I go punch a clock about a month or two, get back on my feet. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Enough to get me a nice something. There it is.
Right.
Straight up. No, it was a certain point in my life, all I thought was the streets. And I knew better. Which is crazy.
Yeah.
So you battled it, man.
So
you actually battled it.
Like I said, I battled until I got shot.
So it wasn't a situation that you had to hustle to survive. That's just something that you chose.
I chose to do.
Yeah,
because I mean, I remember you. Like I said, we grew up together, so I remember clothes and stuff you wore, and it wasn't, you see what I'm saying? So it wasn't one of those situations where you did that to get the shoes or to get the clothes, because evidently your parents provided you for it, so that was just a choice that you made.
Yeah, no doubt.
So, with that being said, man, and like I said, we got some, you know, we're getting close to the end of the show here. Give me something to give a child that's sitting, who could be sitting here watching this, or his parents could take it to him, that's starting to, you know, veer off that road.
I'm going to say this. For you youngsters out there who glorify the fancy cars, the jewelry, these beautiful women and all this here, the penitentiary comes with that. Especially if you're in these streets.
Yeah.
That's the part they not telling you. The penitentiary comes with that. Believe that. No matter how slick you think you are, how smart you think you are, the moves you make and you know stuff you know how to hide, man, if somebody done did it before you, ain't nothing new under the sun.
Yeah.
And listen to your parents. We've been on this earth longer than y'all. Yeah. We know what the hell we're talking about. We not stupid. And the little games you kids running nowadays, it is really lame, man. We done seen it all and done it all. Our parents told us the same thing.
Same thing.
Yeah. But hey, we all have to bump our heads. Look at me, I have to bump my heads 3 times and get shot.
Yeah. All right, man. I mean, you didn't get your hair for. You didn't get your hair for. And so with that being said, we're gonna step away for a couple of. Couple of minutes, then we'll be back.
Yeah. Clearing up for you.
All right.
Yeah.
All right, we're back. We're going to get ready to wrap this thing up. My Life, My Redemption in the Upper Room. We had 4 guests today. We still had 2 that that stuck around. The other two guys had other things or prior engagements that, you know, they needed to do. But first and foremost, we're grateful that, you know, they showed up, man. This is a little different from every other show that we've done to date. It's been eye-opening, if nothing more. You learn something every day. Like I said, I heard about what went on with Edmond, but the detail.
That was real.
The detail, you know, I had to just kind of, you know, soak it all in. And then, if you look at it, all four guests were pretty much doing the same thing, but two different roles. That's kind of amazing.
Yeah.
You know, whether it was, you know, me watching, peer pressure from a family member, or that's just what I chose to do. Mm-hmm. And so, out of all of that, all four were able to, different circumstances took them from that to back to doing what, I guess, what we would say the right thing.
And actually just kind of discredits that whole theory of it's just, well, only these type of kids get involved with it. These four guests have proven there's a number of ways that you can get caught up in that life.
And that was my point about with him, because I was like, I saw, so I know it wasn't that I had to do that to get this or that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because we grew up together. So, with that being said, let's say we have a young man, young lady, now that's away. What advice? Let me switch it up. What advice could you give them, and they get ready to come home, and what advice could you give someone who's potentially headed down that path?
So you say advice giving them coming home?
Yeah, they get ready to come home.
Okay. From being locked up.
Yeah, so we don't want to go that same route. So give me some advice on coming home, injecting myself back in. Exactly.
First thing, man, if you believe in God, hey, go to your local church. It may not be for everybody, but it worked for me. Stay away from old places you used to hang, especially if you know it's a negative environment. Because it's so easy to get sucked back in. You understand, it'd be times and moments you want to go back and hang with your old friends in the old neighborhood, but you know what's going on. You know what I'm saying? You know what's going on back in the neighborhoods. You know they still smoking weed, drinking, popping pills. You know what I'm saying? They still hustling out there. So know what you're getting into before you get into it. And if you don't want to go that route, find a new group of friends. Get early to get you a job. Start hanging with your new group of friends that you work with. Positive people. Somebody that's just headed down in that, you know, down the right path. Join the NAA, because you're going to have to do it anyway, and take it serious. If you plan on staying off drugs, you plan on not getting involved with, you know, alcohol or whatnot, take it serious, man, and be a help to someone else. Because, I mean, a lot of people really do need that help, man. Being on drugs and being on alcohol, it's a real sickness out there, especially with these opioids and stuff nowadays. I ain't trying to take up too much time, but that's the best advice I can give you, man.
It's good, man.
Well, I tell kids now, I try to talk to kids in school, working in school, and like I was telling those earlier about these cats coming to school want to be street athletes. You know what I'm saying? Go and get your 5 cents and two choices. The two choices are left or right. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You use the right choice, you already know you're heading in the right direction. You use the left,
yeah.
I always tell my son, if you go too far left, and you holler for me and I can't hear you, you're on your own, bro. But if you stay right, I can guide you. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that goes for most kids, whether you have a father in your life or not. There's mentors out here, guys sitting around this round table. Don't be scared to come ask me.
Right.
Because I'm keeping 100 with you. Because I've been there, done that, and I know my example, and I know other guys' examples that were close to me. The game is over. It ain't to be told no more. Mm-hmm. That's done. What we done 20 years ago, however it was done, it's not being done in 2020. That's over with. You got too many guys talking, telling, singing, whatever they doing. And you got envy and jealousy. You understand what I'm saying? That catches every day, especially in our community being black. We just don't stick together. You understand what I'm saying? Like we're supposed to. So my whole point would be, don't do it.
Right.
Go to school, get your education. What we lack in that is a lot of trades. Go to automotive, go to welding. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You ain't got to run football or shoot a basketball.
Yep.
Go to one of the trades, man, where you can make big money off the top. Mm-hmm. And that's a lost art right now in the schools today in our black community. We used to be carpenters, roofers, welders. Yeah. Nobody talks about that anymore. I'm a boss for 23 years. That's a good trade.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? You're self-employed, you work for yourself, but remember you work for the public. When you put eight on there, you gotta get an eight, and you keep your doors open. That's how you're gonna pay your bills. Those are trades you can go into when you ain't got it, because you don't want a formal education. College ain't for everybody. Get you a trade, man. Get the school, do what you're supposed to do. And you can be led the right direction that way.
It's back to what he's saying about a trade. That's, I saw an interview recently with Swiss Beats. I didn't know Swiss Beats had went to Harvard. He graduated from Harvard recently, but he said he took some kind of class that was only 3 weeks. He said he learned more in that trade class than he did going 4 years to Harvard or any other university in the country.
Right.
I was like, that's deep.
Let me interject a little something else. And you know, we sit here, we've heard all these different stories, different upbringings. Let me put you on the spot, David. What made you, what kept you from being attracted to that? Because I think that probably out of all of us that sat here at the table, I probably would think that you are probably the only one who didn't get involved in something
I had an abundance of support. I mean, parents that filled my cups up emotionally, mentally. My dad was at every single game.
Yeah.
Everything. My dad came to my referee when I was refereeing. He would sit there. I'm grown. That's the level of support that I had from a child growing up. So with that, you know, and then my grandfather, it wasn't just my parents, my grandfather was right there. I mean, so you're talking about three strong, I mean, education, work hard. I mean, it was drilled in me. I had no choice but to walk that path. And so when I look at a lot of my friends, single parent homes, you know, raised by grandparents, you know, or I mean, so I was so blessed. It's ridiculously blessed. And that situation don't happen. That's rare. That's rare back in the day, and it's definitely rare today.
But I can remember when, you know, because we used to roll together, but, you know, and that was, I had two groups of friends. You know, I had John, and then, you know, I had, so, but I remember one particular time I brought you around, and they was like, man, I want to throw that out there that, you know, not all of us even go down this road, but and it's many of us that we go down this road and we know to pull ourselves out. You know, before we meet the end game, you know, because you can go to prison, you can do this, you can bounce back from that.
Yeah.
You can be shot, you know, stabbed. I've been both. You know, a lot of people don't know that. So, you know, and y'all know more than anybody, but what happened. But the thing is, man, we can come back from that, but we don't come back from a graveyard.
Nope.
And no parent wants to bury their child. I would think that that's probably the most horrible feeling in the world. You know, you hear all the time about people burying spouses, or people burying their parents, but I don't think no parent wants to
bury their child. It's unnatural. It's unnatural.
Man, so with that being said, I'm a step back, man. I'm a give each one of y'all to give me something. I know I had you to do it in your solo segment, but give me something else to give to the viewers. Just something simple, some advice before we go over to Zeke and let him thank the people that we need to thank, and we wrap this thing up.
Hold on, before you do that, I have a question for you.
Go ahead.
When you made your decision after you was in the hospital to walk away from that, how did your friends treat you? Did you get that same level of respect as you did when you was in the game? Or did it just kind of be like, did you feel a difference? Because that's important, because that's what, to me, lures people back in, because you don't want to look like you better than, or, you know, or I'm selling out, or, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Did you have to deal with that, or did they pretty much was like supporting you and be like,
my friends was pretty supportive.
Yeah.
I had a lot of people come see me.
Yeah.
Oldest came see me.
Well, at that age, it's a little different.
That's
too,
true.
Right? Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah. You know, it's a little different. You know, he might not have got that 25 years ago. You know, they might have been like, man, when you get back on your feet, I'm going to, you know. But now it's probably, man, go take care of your family, man.
Yeah.
Be here for your children. So, like I say, so with that being said, one little small piece of advice before we wrap this thing up.
Get one to God every day. Pray and get on your knees. Because if you ask and sincerely ask, he'll give it to you, but most of us are not ready to accept it. We ask for it,
yeah.
When they give it to us, we're not ready to have it, what we're really asking for. So that would be my advice.
Man, my advice would be to just like that brother just said, and pray and push until something happens.
Yeah.
Because they say all the time, it's going to happen. I used to pray every day to start walking again. So, but prayer without work is a dead prayer. You got to remember that. You got to put in the work. Right. God's going to do his part. You got to do your part. Whatever you're praying for, you got to work hard for. And it's gonna come true. That's what I believe.
Okay. All right, man. So, you know, with that being said, we got some people that we want to acknowledge.
Yeah. Thank.
But hold on, before we do that, man, let's thank our guest, man.
Yes, sir.
Four, man, because believe it or not, man, this took a lot of courage, and maybe not to y'all, but this took a lot. And we got people that don't. They want to say stuff, but they don't want us to put their name on here. They don't want to come in. And so,
share that story, man.
Yeah.
Be transparent.
Yeah. And that could be a determining factor in keeping another young person from going down that path. And that was why we wanted to do this. This was, you know, when we got ready to start actually doing this podcast, this was one of the first topics that popped up. When we just had to get the right people here.
Right. Let me say this before we go.
Go ahead.
This is the last advice I'm gonna give these youngsters. That's in the game. Let go of the game before the game let go of you. Because the game can let go of you in an ugly way.
Yeah.
You can get a whole bunch of time that you can't handle. You can get killed. You can be like me. Get shot up and paralyzed, you know, messed up the rest of your life. I got a nerve condition now. I'm walking, I'm thankful for that, but still messed up, man. Yeah. So no one will let go of the game. Let go of the game for the game let go of you.
Can I go on to that?
Go ahead.
And for a lot of y'all don't know, I'm going to go into my statistics. Incarceration rate in the state of Texas, in which we was the highest state, is 218,500. So these politicians, they not playing with y'all. They sending y'all to the penitentiary. The second is California, but I'm not gonna speak on them because I'm from the big state of Texas. The highest number of prisons is not Texas, it's Louisiana. So they sending y'all around the state because you got people that's private contractors now that's going into the prison game because they know us African Americans are going to the penitentiary.
All the Texas workers work for free.
Yes, sir. And then within 3 years of being released, a lot of inmates, 67.8%, is going right back to the federal penitentiary. Because like Edmond said, they don't know how to deal with society when they come out because they go back to the neighborhoods. They go back to their friends that still gang banging or selling drugs and stuff like that. These streets are not for you because behind them brick walls is fried gang. And it's a lot of inmates that come out of that and tell you stories that you probably wouldn't even believe because they was this hard out on the streets, but they was really power puffs inside the penitentiary.
Good stuff there, Fred.
You want to go ahead and thank you for what he said?
Yeah, I want to thank all our people that follow us, that support us on our podcast show. We also on Facebook, The Upper Room, also Upper Room. We're on Instagram, The Upper Room. We're on YouTube, The Upper Room. And we're on Twitter, at The Upper Room. If you have any topics or suggestions that you would like for us to discuss on our show, you can email us at theupperroom409@gmail.com. We want to give a special thanks to Artifacts, Films, Bench Bullying, Busy Bee Cab Stand, Diversity Realty, I probably messed that up, I always mess it up on every show, Element 7 Salon, Era Vintage, Fourtrephotography, that's my son's company, Ground Zero Blog Site, Hempworx, it's not weed, but
it's close.
But it's close. Kiddie, Kampus, Daycare, LC and the 30th Street Jazz Band, Maduro, Cigar Lounge, National Scholar Service, Paqtech, Picture Perfect Photography, that's my cousin Jamisha Harden company, please support her. Tommy Napoli Health and Nutritional Chef, that's one of my childhood friends, he's been a chef for the Houston Rockets, a lot of the NFL players and basketball players, he's good at what he do. Tour Alumni Association, and something Aspirations, what is it? I forget.
Unveiled
Aspirations. Miss Grant, I apologize, but you know, I messed up on the name.
Hey, Fred, you need to continue to mess up on Realty because now you've made that popular, but that's, you know, keep doing it.
So I can work it at?
Right. Don't change it. Don't change it. Because you've done, so maybe you messed it up every show.
Yeah,
so my audience is expecting it.
All right. I like to see this the first time, the second time, man, you have agreed on the
suit. Maybe with that being said, give me a closing thought on it.
Hey, I mean, everybody deserves change, man. We all been through it. You can go through it. Don't be afraid to go talk to people because a long time ago, over 10 years ago, my best friend sitting at this table said, you never know what a person going through unless you talk to them because we'd be going through the exact same thing.
Don't judge. Everybody got a story. There's a rhyme and a reason for why people do what they do. And so that's my whole thing, man. Just hearing these gentlemen's stories, it really touched me. I'm not gonna lie. I mean, and so that's my biggest thing, man. Don't judge. You really don't know what a person is going through. Back to what Freak was saying.
All right, and change is inevitable. It always happens. It's always going. Things are always and forever changing. So you can change and change the game. I guess that's what the thing is. So, with that being said, that's the show. God bless you.
Know about white shirts, starts down jeans with a razor grease, platinum and gold on top of our teeth. What? Big old chains with an iced out piece.